second right therion, it forbids, and the third right therion, it explains everything after the facts are known. The nuclear physics and most of the models in nuclear physics actually belong to this, you know, third category as we know it. So, like crankshell model or particle rotor model, you know, most of the models in, you just get the parameters and try to explain the data after data is known. So, let me the microscopic models in nuclear physics and so for ab initio models. So I've just listed here a couple of them. So you have first of all Green's function. These are so-called state of the art models. So Green's function Monte Carlo method. So with this you can. So this is really ab initio, the basic theory. So with this theory you can explain. You can describe nuclei up to carbon 12. That's it, because of the computational limitations. And so there is also no core shell model. Now you can diagonalize that this no core. So there is no core actually. You start from all the shells of. So with this approach, you can study. You can go up to carbon 14, and you can diagonalize now the facilities which have become available. You can diagonalize up to matrices of 2 billion matrices. Also, there is a couple cluster method. So this is also ab initio, and you start from the first principle. And you can go in this approach, and you can go up to caption 40, 48. But only problem here is that, and you know, you can only study closed shell nuclei at the moment. Although some progress is being done, made to study also open shell nuclei, but right now it's only for closed shell nuclei. So using these so-called ab initio approaches, so there are limitations. You cannot study all the nuclei. Then you have this energy density function approach, and while buoyant, you can study the whole landscape of nuclei. Let me explain. So here is the nuclear landscape. You know, using these ab initio models, and you are restricted to only this low NZ nuclei. So also you can also do those those configuration shell model calculations. While you can go now, you can go. This is not ab initio, but using those with some code, you can go up to n equal to 80. You can study now, and then you have the energy density function approach, and you can study the whole range of nuclei. Actually, it becomes better if you have your systems. So you have accessible using the density functional approach, and all this nuclei are accessible to you. Okay, so BFT, it is used in different, in all kinds of situations, atomic, molecular physics, and especially in quantum chemistry. Actually, it has made a lot of inroads in quantum chemistry. A lot of progress has been made. So it has been also generalized to very different situations, and it has been generalized to finite temperature for time dependent systems. A lot of progress has been made. Also, we know that Nobel Prize was awarded in quantum chemistry using the BFT approach. Now let's compare what's the difference between the Noland approach and Schrödinger approach and the BFT approach. Let's take a very simple system. Now this is meant for actually students. If I take a very simple system, I discretize it. So normally you have to discretize space. Let's say that I take only 20 mesh points in each direction, x, y, and z. So the number of equations using the Schrödinger approach, ab initio approach, that you have to solve is simply 20 raised to 3n. So this is very huge. It's impossible. So a wave function is out of reach for most of the systems. The Schrödinger wave function, you cannot calculate the Schrödinger wave function for most of the systems. Only for for few body system you can do that. But DFT approach, on the other hand, it just depends on your energy density functional depends on this local density, rho r. So therefore, the number equation you are solving is just 20 raised to the power 3 if you have 20 mesh points. So you can see it's like a one-body problem that you solve whatever may be the number of particles. So therefore, you can study any system using DFT, whereas it is impossible, it's not possible. It's out of reach to study a system with more than few particles. So that is the advantage. So basically, you are solving a one-body problem. Okay. Now, so this is based on this density function approach, is based on these Kerr-Mason Hornberg Ohmsham theory, which tells you that so this is, it's easier to discuss these theorems in the atomic case and in the nuclear case, and things become more complicated because it's not clear what is your mean field. And so here it's very clear in the atomic case, and you know the mean field is your the interaction of electrons with the nucleus, and so things are very clear. So you can show, actually I will not discuss, but it's very very easy to show that the ground state properties are described entirely in terms of the local density. If you know the local density, you can calculate the ground state properties. Of course, that's a limitation here. That's the price you have to pay. You can only calculate the ground state properties. Whereas you're showing an approach, and once you know the wave function, of course, you can calculate all the properties of the system. It's very simple, actually. Just in a few steps, you can show that it's a unique density which describes the ground state properties. So it's very, very trivial. I'll not go into details of this, and later on, if some student is interested, we can discuss. It's very, just in a few steps, and you can show that it's a unique density for each physical system. You have a unique local density, and this describes the ground state properties. Now the issue is that how do you calculate that local density? It is the second theorem. The second theorem, which through the variational principle, so as we do in the Schrodinger case, and you minimize your the density functional, and you calculate what is your the local density. So okay. All right. So if in the atomic case, you can write down your energy density. You have this the kinetic energy. You have this the external potential between nucleus and electrons, and then you have this electron-electron interaction. So you can express this completely in terms of local density. That's the theorem. That's what theorem allows you to do that. You can express this. But then the issue is that that's why the complication arises, that you have to also express this this interaction, two-body interaction, kinetic energy, in terms of the local density. So if we can find this what is called a Hornberg cone, which is this kinetic energy density and the this two-body, if you can express this in terms of rho, if you can calculate it exactly, then this is in principle, this is an exact theorem. Yeah? Because this is expressed completely in terms of rho, and only thing what you have to do is you have to express this Hornberg cone function in terms of rho. If you can do that, then in principle it's an exact theory. So you get the same result as you obtain using the Schrodinger approach. So that is the whole problem lies here, that to derive this Hornberg cone functional. You can derive it exactly, so you have the exact theory. Okay, this is what I was saying, that so you can, to derive the density, so you have to just do the variational principle to obtain the density. Okay, again, some comments here. The issue is that if we are exact upon Hornberg functional, then the ground state energy will be exact. So this is independent of external potential, so this is a universal Hornberg functional. And this is basically the reformulation of Schrodinger wave mechanics in terms of the densities. Okay, now in nuclear physics, and that is the purpose of this seminar, is density functional methods in atomic nuclear. So it's a very long history. It started with the Sturm, these articles, these fundamental papers. So what at that time, and this was not really a density functional theory, it was simply what he did. He introduced an interaction, which is basically a local interaction. So you can see delta functions everywhere. Only thing is that he expanded in terms of this momentum of the quadratic terms in momentum, the momentum space. So it's a local interaction. So if you get in the Hartree fork, if you solve using the mean field approach, and what you find is that there's three bodies. So there's a two body and there's a three body piece. So this three body, if you make this mean field approximation, you can show there's this three body. It's a two body with density dependence. So that's why density dependence comes into play. But at that point, it was purely an interaction, nothing to do with density functional theory. It is just that you can express in terms of density, in terms of local density. So it's a local density actually, because of delta function, it's a local density. You can express this, the energy you can express in terms of local density. It just happened. Okay, so then the calculations actually, it was taken to a new level in this paper. We know all of us are familiar with this paper. What the realistic calculations were done using this SCOM interaction, SCOM approach. And a lot of progress has been made over the years, and it has been generalized, it has been deformed nuclear, so different parameterization of Gerard Henderson parameterization of SCOM functional, and Goni, there was some development because it's a zero range interaction. What Goni did, he also introduced finite range for the central part, and so a lot of progress has been made. But then it was realized that to get the compressibility of nuclear matter right, because there's a direct relationship between nuclear compressibility and the density dependence on the SCOM function. So it was shown that in order to get the compressibility of nuclear matter right, you need to have density dependence, and it's fractional. It is between 1 by 6 and between 1 by 6 and 1 by 3. You cannot have the integral density dependence. You should have this fractional density dependence. To reproduce the compressibility properties of nuclear matter, you need to have this fraction. At that point, you cannot have an interaction which gives you this fractional density dependence. It is not possible. Because, let's say if I have three body term, so it is just rho cube. If you have two body term, it is rho square. It's always integral multiple of density. You can never have any interaction. If you start from any realistic interaction, any interaction, you can never have fractional dependence in the density. But in the case of, if I look from the density functional point of view, from the interaction point of view, I cannot go back. If I have fractional dependence in the densities, I cannot go back and to the Hamiltonian. I cannot derive the Hamiltonian from here because there is no way that I can get the one body, two body, three body from this interaction. So at that time, it becomes a density functional theory because using that Cohn-Homburg, it allows you, it gives you a license to have any functional dependence of the density, whether it's integral or fractional or whatever. So that's at that point, the SCOM functional really became the density function, because density function allows you to have any density dependence, whether it's fractional or integral. So then it's a density function approach. So a lot of progress has been made. We also did some calculation. This is an old story now, where we showed that nuclear shell structure changes as you go to drip lines. So there are now various codes available actually for students. Let me mention a little bit about these. So there is HFR, so-called HFR, which solves a SCOM function in three dimensions. So with all the possibilities that you can break any symmetries. Normally most of the codes that you have they impose some symmetries, other things, and like actual symmetry or some. But this is one program which allows you to break all the symmetries. Also there are other also recently. There is a new development using these optimization methods. So normally, when you fit the parameters of the SCOM functional, you take in your input. You have normally spherical nuclei, but for the first time, there are a couple of papers, and but they have also used the former nuclear in the fitting procedure to obtain the parameters of this compound. There's a lot of progress. Okay, so far it's everything looks fine, but now if we dig deeper, if we look at the deeper level, there are problems. So here, this is an old figure now. Let me tell you, a lot of this is some 10 years old figure, maybe older than that, and things have changed, but situation is not very different. Things have improved a little bit, but not very much. And so what you find here is that, so here I have plotted different nuclear models and different interactions, different SCOM functionals, and as I said, there are 100 or more than that SCOM functionals now. So in this, this is the why the data is known, experimental data is known, the quantum energies are known. You can see that all these models and all these parameters, and they tend to agree in this regime where the data is available, because they are fitted. Most of the models are fitted to the known data. But as you go far away from this this major region, you can see there is huge differences. So they just diverge. All the models diverge. So you cannot trust them if you go far from this known region. So you cannot trust any of these models. So this is the basic problem in nuclear physics, because most of the models are fitted.
So what is the binding energy difference with respect to what?
No, here we have taken. Here it's with some mass formula. I think it's with one of those, one of those mass formula we have Zucker that. It is different with respect to that. Yes. If you take some other model as a reference, so things are very, very similar. Things are not very different. Whatever reference you take, things are similar. Okay, now what should be done? One way is that, okay, you fit more parameters. You take into account more data. So that's one way. Now you can cure for this problem, that you obtain better results. But recently, there's a paper, actually it is now published, I think it's published in 2014 in Physical UC. What they have shown, actually, if you include more and more data, because here you can include also deformed nuclear now, as I said, these modern optimization methods, and you can include deformed, you can include whole range of data now. So they have shown that if you add more and more data, the improvement of the results does not change. So it doesn't improve the results. So if you calculate bonding energies, other things, so they don't change. So you have reached that, the limiting that situation, that you cannot, by incorporating more and more those parameters, the experimental data, it doesn't improve the results. So you have reached that the end point. Now, no, also the SCOM also. If you also try to, different SCOM interactions. If you take not only different mass probability, but SCOM interactions. If you try to go beyond the non-regional, you find that they also diverge. Not as much as here, but they also diverge. Yeah, no, in SCOM also you are fitting, basically. In whichever model you take, in nuclear physics, in some way you are fitting. Of course, you are not fitting those many parameters, like in the case of mass formula, you fit whole range of nuclear. But these six parameters you fit in the case of SCOM. But some fitting is required in every model. But of course, SCOM, the things are not so bad. Yeah, so no, what I said, yes. So so mass formula you cannot really say that, because if you take it beyond, so it will not work. And for SCOM also, if you take them beyond that fitted region, so if you try to predict bonding energies of a triple nuclear, you find also they vary from one parameterization to other parameterization. They vary. But it depends on, because yeah, so
that's why this prediction will not work. This prediction will not work.
Yeah. No, but I'm saying that different, if you use different parameterization of SCOM, they lead to different results.
That's right.
So that is. So now, if you try to fit more and more, as has been done here, it does not, it does not lead to,
does it require minimum number of nuclear mass to be known so that the fitting is optimal?
Yeah.
Or
no, you need, because your six parameters, at least you need six data sets.
No, so
so what is normally done, you fit the properties of the closure nuclear. Quantic energy is the radial closure nuclear. But in this work, they also try to fit also deformed nuclear. Not only closure nuclear. There is a minimum requirement, of course, because you have some six parameters. So you need to have at least six data points. So normally in all the SCOM functionals, so you use that closure nuclear. Because normally you fit the spherical. Because deformed nuclear, you cannot do deformed calculation. It was not possible to do deformed calculation for the whole periodic table and then fit the parameters. But now it's possible actually with all the modern computations. So earlier you were just fitting the closure nuclear. So it was easier because you just run this spherical code, which just takes few minutes. So it was easier. But now also with the computational facilities, you can also fit a deformed nuclear. This is what has been done here actually. If it also deformed nuclear, but it turns out you have reached the end point, it does not help you, it does not improve the results. If you keep up, you can add more and more to these data points, you have reached the limiting point. It does not improve the results. So what should be done now?
You mean keeping the same number of parameters?
Same number of parameters.
You are not increasing number of parameters.
No, you are not. So keep the same number of parameters. For a given SCOM functional, you keep the number of parameters, but you try to improve, you try to include more data sets. Because in this approach, you can do that. You go deformed nuclear, so it does not improve the properties, the major properties.
Have they tried to drop the closed cell nuclei and take only the deformed nuclei and see what is different?
No, they also include spherical, deformed, all kinds of. Because once you have deformed, you can also.
The thing is, once you have a model which does the prediction for the deformed nuclei.
Yeah.
You have the fitting only taking data from the deformed nuclei, and how well do they predict the closed cell?
No, I think what they have done, they use both spherical as well as deformed nuclei.
Okay.
No, because if you have deformed code, you can also have spherical solution. No problem with that. You can also have spherical solution. If you have two-dimensional code, you can also have spherical solution. Then you also fit. You can also fit both spherical as well as deformed.
No, but what he is asking that you fit only deformed nuclei, don't take spherical nuclei,
yeah,
and then see what happened to the spherical case. That's what he's asking. That don't take spherical nuclei, take only deformed system.
Okay.
And then see what happened to the prediction of the spherical case.
Yeah, but I'm not sure whether that would be very helpful. Okay, so, but spherical, I mean, there is no difference between, I mean, if you take a deformed system, 3D system, there is no difference between spherical and deformed nuclei. With just solution, you get spherical solution. Other case, you get deformed solution. So there's no difference. If you use spherical code, of course, if you use spherical code, then you're restricted to spherical shapes only. If you take deformed code, 3D code, then you have accessibility to all nuclei. You can have spherical solution, you cannot deform solution.
It's unlikely that it will be able to explain spherical nuclei by fitting only with the deformed.
But this is what I'm trying to say. Spherical is just a special case. The deformation is zero. That's it. So there's no difference.
That information does not go inside the parameters.
It does not go, but whether, I'm not sure whether that will really change anything. Okay, you are not using all the information. Like earlier, you were using only spherical. You are not using deformed. Now you are using deformed, not spherical. It will not change. Okay, so it's an interesting point. Okay, I'm not sure whether it will change the parameter sets or not, but okay, so.
Actually, Javed, there is a calculation which is called density-dependent point coupling model. there yeah. they have fitted only 64 deformed nuclei. And I don't think thing really changed actually. So
it doesn't so change.
Yeah. So if you film only.
No, I don't think it will change really. No, unless you change the function. If you change the functional, then of course, and then things will be different. Of course, things may change. But if you keep the functional same, and number of parameters same, and then I'm not sure whether it will change anything. Anyway, so it's a good point. Okay, so now how do we go beyond? Okay, that's the point. So so far, we have seen that if you take if you add in more and more these data points, it does not really help you. So how do you go forward now? So the way to go forward is to change the functional, to put more physics in the functional. Because we know that there, the functional that we have been using is very approximate, very crude, and it has been there for last 60, 70 years, and we have not changed the functional. Maybe here and there we have changed the parameters and some terms we have changed here and there, but the functional as such has not changed very much. So we change the functional. So there are different ways that you can improve on the density function. Different ways. And here I'll just list the three of them. So one way is that, okay, as I said at the beginning, that SCOM, the interaction, it has only up to quadratic terms. You know, momentum up to quadratic terms and momentum. So you can improve on that, you can go beyond quadratic terms. So that's one way. Of course, things become more and more complicated. I mean, more parameters, then you have to fit more parameters. But this is one way. Some work has been already done by the Machevsky, others. They have included higher order terms. The other possibility is that the spin properties. This is very important. So also some work by improving the tensor terms in the function. So this also, a lot of work is being done in this particular project. But the other is to improve the isospin dependence of, include the isospin symmetry, which is not. So all the functional density functions that we have, whether relativistic, non-relativistic, common, they break this isospin symmetry. I'll explain. So this is what we have been working for last 1 or 2 years. Improve the isospin dependence of the density function. Now, what do I mean by isospin dependence? You know, if you look at the density functional, any density functional, it is completely expressed in terms of rho n and rho p. You have neutron and proton density. You don't have this neutron-proton density is not there. If you also look from the isospin point of view, you know, you have only rho 0 and rho 3. You don't have rho 1, I mean rho x and rho y, you don't have. So these are the terms which mix the neutron and proton. It is like your, C dagger and CP, that, so it will change.
Behind
it. You know, your rho n, actually it is rho n. It's like phi 0, see that n, phi 0. So rho np should be phi 0. So these terms are not there. If you look from isospin point of view, as I said that you have rho 0, rho 3, you don't have rho 1 and rho 2 are not there. Rho x and rho 1 are not there. Rho y are not there. So if you demand, yeah, please.
We have included only local terms. So we have also included non-local term of density.
No, this is local density.
But we can also improve the model by including the non-local term of.
Yeah, this is what is done in Gooney. Yeah. This is what is done in Gooney interaction. You have non-local terms.
Is it already included or
no? We are using SCOM. SCOM, it's a local. There are no non-local terms. It's only local. SCOM interaction. You can also do Boolean, so while you have small local terms, finite range. Actually, they also, it was earlier only for the central potential, they have also extended to other parts of the functional. So, you can do that in the Boolean, but things, we know that things do not change very much. Is finite range. Yeah, that's one way you can improve. It improves somewhat, but not to great extent. You know that. I mean, Boolean has been there, but the results are, you know, there have been several of those, you know, comparisons and have been done, and things are not very different. Okay, so this is what, all right. Now, if you demand the isospin symmetry, if you say that isospin symmetry should be conserved, then all these terms should be treated at equal level, all these terms. So you have this, you have in the standard functional, you know, you have only rho n and rho p n, so therefore all the functionals, they break the isospin symmetry. So in order to preserve the isospin symmetry, you need to have this term at the same depth as rho n and rho p. Actually, there are empirical observations. You really need this isospin symmetry. So this problem has been there, you know, since the work of Meyer actually. If you try to calculate bonding energies of n equal to z nuclei, you find that there's a cusp in the bonding energies at n equal to z. This is a well-known thing. This is known from 60s, you know, so this is not. So what you need to do actually, what was done from the time of Meyer, and you know, they include this term and proportional t, what's called as Wigner term. Also, not only in those mass formulae, also in the SCOM functional. Yes. If you want to reproduce the data for n equal to z, you have to put by hand this Wigner term. By hand, it's not there in the functional. So there have been some studies and where they have shown actually this Wigner, the original vector term is the isospin symmetry, because you are breaking isospin symmetry in the normal SCOM functional. So that is the reason.
Yeah, please.
Usually
that term is applicable for low mass.
Yeah, that's why, yes,
of course. But when you go for
higher mass, then it's not. Only for n equal to z.
Much lower.
N equal to z, yeah.
Yeah.
Higher mass, you don't have n equal to z nuclei.
Yeah, you don't have n equal to z.
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, see, for larger nuclei, n can play a role. I mean, if you go to ZSTS and all that.
Yeah. Well, n equals z. So that's why we know that for this low Nz nuclei, you need this so-called neutron proton interaction. We know that there are a lot of studies and we did incorporate that. So we have constructed this functional, new functional, strong functional, with all the terms now. We have rho zero. Also, we have this is the isoscalar, the isovector. In the isovector, as I said, you have in all the functions, you have only the rho 3 component of this. We also consider now rho 1 and rho 2 component. So all of them are there. So in nuclear physics and things, you have also other densities, and you know, you have this spin density, kinetic density, current density. In all the densities, and you have to incorporate, you have to include these in isovector terms. So this is what we have done. And you can construct the energy functional. This is slightly more complicated. So including all these terms, isoscalar, isovector terms, and only thing you have to keep in mind that you have to preserve the isospin symmetry, also the rotational symmetry, you can construct your function. Up to quadratic terms only, of course, only so we restrict only up to quadratic terms. Okay, so let me show you. I'm not going to details. We have already published, something is already published, so I'll give the reference if somebody is interested. So we have published last year in physical research. Okay, so we have done some model study just to check, just to see what this model predicts, you know, because there are these new terms. And so we have made this model study, the so-called isotracking model. This is very simple. We can see what kind of results we have a track, check whether the results are correct or not, as I'm going to show you. It's a very simple model. If you go to realistic case, then it's not clear how to check your model, your calculations, other things. But in this model, we can really test the results. Okay, so we can show that if you you know, impose this Cambriosis symmetry, we can show that using the phases that we have adopted for Ty equals 0. So therefore, it's only two-dimensional. So we have this x and z. So you can also rewrite this in terms of you can write theta and some this angle. Okay, so this is not very difficult. You can rewrite. So you have these 2 degrees of freedom. You can write it as theta and this the length of that lambda prime. Okay, so let me show you some results now. So this is using this isoplanking model. So this is about a equal to 78. So you start from nickel 78, you go to tin. This is for these isobars, a equal to 78 isobars. So here you can see that without the Coulomb, if you have no Coulomb interaction, you can see that the energy is exactly same. This is what you expect, because if you are isolated in symmetry, the energy should be same for all these isobars. So this is a very good chapter in this borderline. So if you keep on changing this theta, basically you are changing the particle number. So you see that all of them have the same energy. And if you have the Coulomb energy here, with the Coulomb energy, so of course things are different, because you are putting more and more as you go from this side to this side, you are putting more and more protons in. So you can see that the Coulomb energy, the total energy actually it drops in, because Coulomb energy increases. Alright, so now if you calculate the Tx and Tz, so you can see that you have the maximum. Tx gives you what is the neutron proton, you know, the mixing term. How much is the mixing between neutrons and protons? You can see at the end points, it's almost zero, there is no mixing. But if you go to the middle, you know, n equals z, this is exactly what we are discussing. And if you go to n equals z, your maximum neutron proton mixing is there. Also, if you, you can also calculate Tz and just see whether everything is correct or not. And here you have your Tz equal 11, your Tz equal minus 11. You go from one isobaric chain to other isobaric chain. Also, if you calculate T square, you see without Coulomb interaction, you have T square is 132 point something. Actually, it should be exactly 132. Yeah, please. Because there was some discussion actually, and so that's why. Okay, so now if you calculate this T square, you can see that the T square without Coulomb, it is not exactly 132. It should be T into T plus 1, T square T into T plus 1, it should be 132 for T equal 11. But you see that it is not same, because there is the mean field also breaks when you do the mean field calculations. It breaks your isospin symmetry, so it is not exactly 142. It is slightly different. Of course, if you put the Coulomb interaction, then you can see that. So you have the maximum this isospin this breaking is at near n equal to z. Now, what is interesting? I'm not going to details of these, but what is interesting is that if you calculate single particles, states and from one isobaric system to other isobaric, like we said, from nickel 78, if you go to this tin 78, and what you find is that, so they become here unbound. This G9 half here, this state becomes unbound here. Whereas if you do, we have also done these calculations using the standard, using so-called HF-RAD, as some of you know. This is using normal Sturm functional. So what we find is that the nuclei which become unbound, here it is slightly different. Like here in the case of with this isospin symmetry, using this new functional, we find it's called molybdenum, around molybdenum, it becomes unbound. Whereas if you do the standard Sturm functional, you find it is a zirconium, so it changes. So it is not so. So what we are seeing here, of course, these are only model calculations. So we see that that drip lines may change if you have this isospin invariant Sturm functional. The reason is that so you have these states here, we are not, you can see that this here is a neutron state, it becomes a proton state here. But in the middle of, you know, in this whole, this domain, you have this neutron-proton mixing. So the state here, what you have here, gene, it is not a completely proton state. There's a mixing from also from neutron. You know, so you cannot really say this is, especially here, if you are closed N equal to C system. You know, so this state here is equal. If you have no Coulomb, then the state near N equal to Z has equal mixing of protons and neutrons. It is not proton or neutron, equal mixing. If you go away, it is not equal, it is more protonation, but there is a neutron contribution here. So each state, there is some contribution, although it is small as you go towards this proton triploid, it is small, but there is a neutron. So you expect, therefore we expect that the triploids may change, because you know, the proton will not feel the same, the proton state, because it has mixing from neutrons, it will not feel the same Coulomb potential as if it were a purely proton state, you know, because it has some neutron contribution. So what we expect is that the proton, the triploids, especially proton triploids, will change them with this isospin, with this new scope function. Yeah, please.
When you look for this red region, where it is highly mixed, so if you do the knockout type of reaction, like does this model predict some spectroscopic factors which are different than the standard Sturman reaction?
Yeah, those we have to calculate. Those will change for sure. Because if it is equal mixing, not equal mixing, because the Coulomb energy will change that. But there'll be a mixing between protons and neutrons. So all those major properties will change, for sure. So it will not be, your state is not purely, what we are saying, it is not purely neutron or proton. In the middle. So of course we have to do realistic, this was only a model study, we have to do realistic calculations, so then only we can make some concrete predictions. But we see that, we expect that there will be change, for sure, there are going to be changes. No, because of mixing of neutrons and proton states, and so the proton triploid will be slightly different. From how different they will be, and it's only when we do proper, you know, realistic calculations, and then we'll be able to say that how exactly the triploids will change. Also, we have also included, so this what I said was only using the SCOM functional. I did not discuss the pairing. We have also now incorporated pairing in this isospin invariant pairing, just the time is limited. Just let me only discuss the results. So we get actually two solutions. You know, in this case, in this particular case with in this iso cracking, we get two solutions. In one case, they have the exactly same energy. If you don't have Coulomb interaction, with Coulomb interaction, they are slightly different, but without Coulomb interaction, they are exactly same. The energy is exactly same. The difference between them is that in one case of neutron, neutron, proton, proton, you know, those identical pairing, it dominates, whereas the neutron, proton pairing is very small. In the other solution, you find that, you know, this one, it dominates. The neutron, proton pairing dominates. So this tells you that, you know, there have been a lot of publications about the importance of neutron, proton pairing. It tells you that it doesn't make any sense to talk about that neutron-proton pairing, because they are the two parts of the same coin. You cannot say they are the two solutions, at least at the mean field level. You cannot talk about neutron-neutron, the parts of neutron-proton pairing, because they have described the same state, but two different ways of expressing the same state, the same energy state. Let me conclude now. So we have developed this new SCOM functional. Also, I did not discuss because time was limited. There is also another. So what it was developed using the so-called HFETHO code, where you preserve the actual symmetry. But also we have also introduced this in the HFART, where you use three-dimensional and compare the two results, because programs are totally different. HFETHO, HFART, and so we have shown the two programs give identical results up to some decimal place, and so they are. So our preliminary, you know, we have not done a realistic calculation, but this model calculation tells us that the proton required a change in this using this new functional. Also, we get these two degenerate solutions, which are equivalent. Just as I said, the two sides of the coin, so you cannot really say, at least at the mean feed out, you cannot differentiate between neutron proton or neutron proton. They have the same. Okay, now we have to go. It's just we are just warming up as far as this block is concerned. It's for just preliminary block, and so we have to go a long way in. And the basic actually. Basic aim is to study beta decay and double beta decay, weak interaction using this new function. Okay, thank you. Normally what you have is your rho zero square. You know, so you have some C zero, rho zero square, plus C one, rho three square. No, it is just one of the terms.
So rho zero is either
neutron or proton. No, rho zero is rho n plus rho p, and rho three is rho n minus rho. So basically, so this is the normal function. This is the way you do. You can either write it, or you can write it in terms of